Hello and welcome back. Please subscribe to support our channel. And in this episode, we're going to conduct the maiden flight on this Douglas DC-3. And this isn't our normal field, so special thanks to Phoenix Model Aero Club for hosting us while our own field is mown and rolled.
In the last episode, we conducted a range check and also a check of the failsafe. And since then, we've changed the failsafe slightly so that the gear comes down when the failsafe is activated. We've rechecked the centre of gravity. We've also made this wing bag from Mylar insulation material and duct tape, and that's to get the aircraft to the field without damage. Then we've assembled it and checked it over, ready for flight. Mm-hmm. Bother. So what happened then? Well, if I'm honest, it came off the ground a little sooner than I was anticipating, and it continued to pitch up until it stalled and then it dropped a wing and crashed. I suspect the centre of gravity was too far aft as it continued to pitch up even with a down elevator input. So the damage was reasonably extensive. The repairs were quite simple and took around 3 hours. The most difficult repair, of course, was the one to my pride. The mouldings took the brunt of the damage, and these were repaired using patches of fiberglass wetted with thin CA on the inside. Meanwhile, the wooden parts had to be splintered and rejoined. Whilst making the repairs, I was disappointed to discover that the wingtips were twisted with wash-in. That is to say that the angle of incidence was around 2 degrees higher at the tip than it is at the roots. This just wouldn't do, so we twisted the wings back straight by hand and re-shrunk the covering with a heat gun. The ailerons, however, had to be split up the trailing edge with a knife and reset to the correct twisted profile and re-glued. Making the repairs all look pretty again took quite a bit of effort. However, once again, to the rescue, the swatch of matching silver covering, and of course the airbrush.
Hello again. Back at our own patch now with all the repairs carried out. We've also moved the centre of gravity forwards around 5 millimetres and added some washout to the wingtips, particularly the ailerons too. We'll see if that works any better.
The ground was pretty wet this day, but still you can see how keen the aircraft is to pitch over onto its nose. What doesn't help this is that the landing gear knuckles aren't quite straight, as we'll see again later perhaps. So we'll give it a helping hand and try again. Airborne at last. And with the landing gear retracted, now we'll trim for roll and then retract the flaps and trim for pitch. First check. And there we are, trimmed, hands off. And now, applying power, we'll see if she pitches up or down as we climb to height.
Okay, so here we're going to try a stall and recover. It needs to fly quite quickly. Try that again.
Wow, so the stall with the flaps retracted has a severe amount of wing drop, and just look how much height we lose during the recovery.
Now we're going to try the same thing with flaps selected. So first, does it pitch up or down with flaps? Down, this is slap stage one. And there's the stall, it's more benign.
So the stall with the first stage of flaps is far less fierce, perhaps due to more effective washout across the wings, and the landing gear and also the flap to elevator compensation of 2 millimeters down elevator with the first stage of flaps is about correct.
This is down a little, gear down.
Now let's check the stall in the landing configuration.
So it's more benign with the flaps down, probably due to increased washout. So the next thing I want to do is retract the flaps and gear, and we'll do a center of gravity check on altitude. So here we are trimmed, the fly hands off, wings level, half power, and I'm pitching down, and she's pitching down slightly, so the center of gravity is still slightly too far aft.
Even with the center of gravity set at 95 millimeters, she still tucks a little in a gentle dive, which means more nose weight required. Now let's get a look at this beautiful aircraft set against this moody sky. As a treat for our viewers, we have placed a Foxeer run cam in the flight deck, giving you a view out of the captain's window. With this setup, you can expect an 8-minute flight with 30% in reserve from a 4000 mAh pack. The control throws stated in the instructions seem reasonable, although I would prefer some more rudder authority, particularly for takeoff.
Conclusions then. We have to remember that this is quite a cheap and cheerful kit. But first, the things that we really liked. It's very pretty and it really captures the lines in the era of 1930s, 1940s air travel, which was very glamorous. Assembly is quite typical for an armoured fighter to fly, and hence quite simple.
The things that weren't so good. Well, firstly, the centre of gravity, as stated, is incorrect.
And From our findings, it should be 90 to 95 millimetres back from the leading edge of the wing. Likewise, there's this business of the twisted wingtips with wash in, and it's just incorrect. There is quite a bit of work in correcting this problem. Without doing it, it's almost unflyable. At the factory, of course, these two little changes, the centre of gravity and the twist on the wings, would cost almost nothing to correct and would massively improve the quality of this product. I hope you're listening, VQ Models. Finally, for the price of the landing gear assembly, for the retracting landing gear, really there should have been flaps filed on each of those metal bars. We shouldn't have had to take them apart and do it ourselves. This kit is around £200, and for that price you could buy the CNC set of Tony Niehaus parts, including the plan and additional stripwood, etc., and vacuum form mouldings. And I think that would be better value. It's likely to fly better as it's a little bit lighter and you can control specifically how it's put together. Also, Top Flight make a really nice DC-3 kit, although there's significantly more building. It's a little bigger, but again, it's likely to be better as you can control the build and it's quite a bit lighter. Would I have another one of these? Perhaps not. However, that's not to say I wouldn't have another VQ Models aircraft. It's just that with being highly tapered, as this design, the DC-3 is, the faults are amplified when it comes to the flying qualities. I hope you enjoyed this series. Please tune in for more reviews and more aero modelling, in general making things, on our channel. And don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.